I declare the amendment passed. Mr. James To has given notice to move his first amendment in Appendix 1 to amend Clauses 9 and 12. The Secretary for Transport and Housing has also given notice to move his second amendment in Appendix 1 to amend Clauses 9 and 12. Mr. Dennis Kwok has also given notice to move his first amendment in Appendix 1 to amend Clauses 9 and 12. This amendment is the same as the foregoing amendment moved by the Secretary. That is about the status of trustee and guardians to, on behalf of the mentally incapacitated persons, to purchase domestic properties that may be exempted from the stamp duty requirement.
The committee will vote on Mr. James To's first amendment first. If it is carried, the STH will not be able to move his second amendment. Since Mr. Dennis Kwok's first amendment is the same as the STH's amendment, if Mr. James To's amendment is vetoed, I would only ask the STH to move his second amendment. Whether or not the STH amendment is passed, Mr. Dennis Kwok will not be able to move his first amendment. If Mr. James To's first amendment and the STH second amendment are both vetoed, then Mr. Dennis Kwok will not be able to move his second amendment later either. Members can now speak on the relevant parts of the original clauses 9 and 12. And also, to have a joint debate on the amendments mentioned about those clauses, I will first ask Mr. James To to speak and move his first amendment, and then I will ask the STH and Mr. Dennis Kwok to speak, but they cannot move any amendment at this stage. Mr. James To. Page 15. Chairman, I move my first amendment as in Appendix 1 of the script to further amend Clauses 9 and 12. My amendment is about a person helping a mentally incapacitated person to set up a trust in order to buy residential property, that there should be exemption of the BSD. It is like this, Chairman. Actually, this is the same exception for minors, but the administration has adopted Mrs. Regina Ip's proposal. Many members, and including myself, have commented on that proposal, so they should be in the same group. What happens is, BSD is exempted for Hong Kong PRs, but if there are people who are mentally incapacitated amongst Hong Kong PRs, but they have a need to buy property, then what happens? These persons have to go through an adult who is not mentally incapacitated to help him. If that person himself is a Hong Kong PR, there would not be a problem. But if that person is not a Hong Kong PR, the ILD will say, on the face of it, you are purchasing residential property as a non-Hong Kong PR, so you need to pay 15% BSD. But in fact, that person is doing so on behalf of a mentally incapacitated Hong Kong PR. He is only the trustee, and the beneficiary is actually a Hong Kong PR, and so there should be exemption. The Hong Kong administration still maintains that concept because it thinks it is necessary. I also think it is necessary. My amendment is only a minor amendment. I like to ensure that the person who is the trustee must have gone through a legal process. In other words, that he has to be appointed by the court, or according to the mental health ordinance, he is appointed as the designated trustee. So that, to put it bluntly, I don't want any Tom, Dick or Harry to act on behalf of the mentally incapacitated person to set up a so-called trust so that this person can avoid paying the BSD. I'm just trying to plug a loophole. The administration says that actually there is no loophole because the ILD will ask the trustee for documentary evidence. But you must understand, the law is the law. The law says as long as there is a trustee or someone claims himself to be a trustee, and he can appoint himself as the trustee using legal documents, and then he can buy residential property, and he says this is done on behalf of a mentally incapacitated Hong Kong PR. The ILD asks for documents, and he can give you the documents. And what are the documents? The documents would be an agreement for sale bought on the basis of a trust. And maybe that person is totally unrelated to the mentally incapacitated Hong Kong PR, but according to law, exemption is still provided. I don't know why the administration refuses to adopt my amendment as the administration's amendment, but it refuses to do so. It insists that people should not even support my amendment, because it says it has administrative measures. In other words, it is of the view that administrative measures can override the law. This is not the right mentality. You can say, I can always ask for documentation. And when people say there is little documentation, what would you do? Do you charge the BSD? No, because as long as you are a trustee in the law, you don't have to pay BSD. So my amendment is to plug a possible loophole. Actually, in the paper submitted by the administration, it says that this person has to put forward some documentary evidence, such as a court order or guardianship order under the guardianship ordinance or the trust ordinance. But mainly, they are talking about appointments under the mental health ordinance. This is what the administration says as documents that are to be supplied. And I'm just saying that this should be entrenched in the law and allow them to become legal requirements. At present, these are just administrative requirements that can be brushed aside. I urge members to support this simple and minor amendment. Since it is a joint debate, Mr. Chairman, I will also talk about withdrawing the exemption for minors. Chairman, indeed, in the blue bill, there is an exemption for minors. This exemption for minors is even explained in a pamphlet to explain the BSD issued by the IRD. At the time, it says, well, these are in FAQ mode, and in question 7, I'm talking about a document issued by the IRD. If a non-Hong Kong PR makes use of a trust to buy Hong Kong residential property on behalf of a Hong Kong PR, does the BSD have to be paid? And the answer is, by the ILD, non-Hong Kong PRs in the capacity of a trustee buys property or signs an agreement of sale on behalf of a Hong Kong PR, he has to pay the BSD, except that Hong Kong PR is a minor or is mentally incapacitated. End of quote. When the pamphlet was issued, it was explaining to the public after the measures were announced, after the blue bill was drafted. This is an announcement to the public to help them understand the complex bill. In other words, there are two exemptions. One for a Hong Kong PR who is a minor and a Hong Kong PR who is mentally incapacitated. These people will enjoy exemption. Indeed, this may be open to abuse. And if it is abused, I should put it this way. First, from the perspective of fairness, Hong Kong PR minors should be treated the same as adults. But if there is a trustee, then will there be a loophole which is so big that the administration thinks that an originally fair principle will have to be thrown out? Mr. Chairman, this is a very difficult decision indeed. The question is, we see a big loophole. But we must also have regard for a fair system. What should we do? Number one, from the policy angle, a Hong Kong PR minor may be able to have residential property purchased through other people. Actually, in most circumstances, this minor will be living with a guardian or other adults. In other words, if the administration uses the angle that these are extraordinary measures for exceptional times, in other words, it is not that a minor can never purchase property. At this time, because there is tight land supply, we are saying that minors will not be able to purchase property through a trustee. Well, I think that's okay, but is this going to be a long-term measure? If in case this measure will continue, then at a certain time, someone will challenge you that this is unfair. Even if it is for the short term, it is still unfair. But if it is extended for longer periods, the unfairness will be open to more challenge. Secondly, Mr. Dennis Kwok's amendment that you have already announced there will be exemption for Hong Kong PR minors. They can use a trust and they are exempted. In other words, there will be people who would like to make use of this exemption in order to buy residential property. If that's the case, and for the moment, information we have got from the administration does not tell us that in the interim, that is, in case this is going to be passed, whether there will be a big number of transactions of this type. If you tell me there are just a few transactions of this type, then even if we pass Mr. Dennis Kwok's amendment to provide exemption, the impact will not be great. However, if many people do this, then I would ask this question of fairness. If the administration misleads them, then what happens? Now, of course, you can also say the opposite. You can say the law may not be passed. There is uncertainty. And also, even if it is for negative vetting, which will be debated, then somehow, magically, we can veto the administration even through split voting. But in the blue bill, you have already talked about an exemption. Generally speaking, if you say there will be a tax to be charged and in the end the tax will not be charged, then the impact is all right because the money will be refunded by law firms. But of course, the chance is slim. If the bill is not passed, then the $4 billion odd will have to be returned to the buyers. That's natural. But alternatively, since you said a tax will be charged, but tax will not be charged in certain circumstances, so actually that money will not have to be deposited in law firms, but certainly now you withdraw the exemption. Without Mr. Dennis Kwok's amendment, then there will be unfairness done to certain people, or at least these people will have been misled. I believe you should be very careful in proposing legislation. If it has been proposed, and if you really want to withdraw the exemption, and of course if you do not depend on that kind of revenue for expenditure, and if it does not do anything about fairness, then I can't see why you cannot support Mr. Dennis Kwok's amendment. The DP supports it. Secretary,
Mr. Chairman, the administration proposes to amend clauses 9 and 12 of the bill. The content of the amendments is in the paper circularized to members. The objective is to withdraw the exemption provided for in the bill with regard to the acquisition of residential property by minors through guardians and trustees, and these minors are Hong Kong PRs. I would like to briefly talk about the amendments, and then I will briefly respond to Mr. James Toh's amendment. Under the bill, Hong Kong PR buyers act on behalf of themselves in order that they can be exempted from the BSD. And then for minors who are Hong Kong permanent residents, they are not in a position to enter into legally binding agreements. And so if they want to acquire residential property, they have to, there is a genuine need for others to act on their behalf. And so there is this exemption. And in other words, the property is acquired by the minor, but then there is the trustee or guardian acting on his behalf. We understand that the Bills Committee is worried that the proposed BSD exemption may easily be abused. As a result, the effectiveness of BSD will diminish. And I thank members for having reminded the administration about the possibility of abuse. And that's why Mrs. Regina Yip has proposed an amendment to withdraw the BSD exemption for minors who are Hong Kong PRs and who acquire property, and there is a trustee or a guardian acting on his behalf. And Mrs. Ip's proposal will tighten up the exemption, and as a result, there will be able to effectively give priority to the home ownership needs of Hong Kong permanent residents. And also, we are of the view that, generally speaking, minors will be taken care of and by their parents and guardians, and they tend to live with their parents and guardians. And so we do not think their housing needs will be jeopardized because of the withdrawal of the exemption. And we've also sought legal advice. We are of the view that the Mrs. Yip's amendment is acceptable both from the policy perspective and from the legal perspective. And so the administration has accepted this suggestion, and we're moving these amendments to clause 9 and clause 12. So this amendment, in fact, can address the Bills Committee's concerns. And in fact, there was in-depth discussion in the Bills Committee on the arrangement, and members in general expressed support, and I hope that members will vote in favor of these amendments later on. And concerning Mr. Toh's amendment, I think the amendment and our amendment do not differ in principle. Then we, of course, we want to prevent abuses, and so it depends on how far I would like to go concerning the restriction. After very careful consideration, the administration has found it difficult to accept Mr. James Toh's amendment. Now, the administration has decided to withdraw the exemption arrangements for Hong Kong PR minors. But then the administration is of the view that for those who are mentally incapacitated, they will have a greater need to purchase residential property than minors. And also another bill, in order to get the exemption, the persons concerned need to provide written evidence. And Mr. Toh's amendment will cause some inconvenience to some mentally incapacitated persons. And so the administration of the view, there is no need to further tighten the BSD exemption arrangements for Hong Kong PRs who are mentally incapacitated. I will give a consolidated response after I've heard members' views. Mr. Dennis Kwok.
I'm going to speak on the CSA at the latest stage of the discussion or debate when we deal with Section 70 of the bill. But since I noticed members have already started discussing my CSA, I might as well go into it now to explain the reason behind my decision of moving the present CSA to the bill. The reason for moving my CSA, Mr. President, is really for one purpose and one purpose only, which is to remove the retrospective effect of the Honorable Regina Yip's CSA, which has been adopted by the administration, to remove the BSD exemption for acquisitions of property by Hong Kong permanent resident minors through their trustees and guardians. I shall hopefully convey to all of you in this speech the very important, in my view, legal principles at stake and how the failure to pass my CSA may leave the bill open to later challenges in court. To illustrate the legal principles involved, let us consider the following example. Mr. President, suppose you are to go to the internet and you look at a website and you see a book you want to buy. And the website tells you that this book costs $100 with shipping costs and tax included in the price tag. And just to be doubly sure, you call up this company and you ask them, how much is this book? Is it really $100? And the personnel at the company say to you, yes, it's $100 including shipping costs and including taxes. That's all you have to pay. So happily, you pay for the book with the $100 bill. And a couple of months later, the company called you back and say, well, sorry, there's been a change of policy. Now this book will cost $130. And you say, hang on a minute. When I asked you, you made a very clear and unequivocal representation to me saying that this book costs $100 with everything included. Now this change of policy was without notice to me, but the company say, I'm sorry, we're not going to give you this book unless you pay us $130 with the extra cost that you were unaware of. Now, of course, everyone, having heard this example, would say, well, we're probably never going to do business with this company again, because no one in this world does business this way, and certainly not in Hong Kong. When the government, when the administration tells you that a certain class of person will be exempted from a bill, or from certain taxes, you are entitled to rely on that representation going forward in the way you organize, in the way you decide whether to enter into a certain transaction. And this is the nub of it, Mr. President. I've no doubt that even primary school students understand the injustice and unfairness in the example which I've just cited. It is no surprise then that the common law courts have for centuries, Mr. President, recognize such an injustice and develop the doctrine of equitable estoppel for real-life cases that are similar to the situation that we're facing here. Specifically, the common law doctrine of equitable estoppel says that even if one party has the legal right to do something, such as to charge an online shopper, in our example, for the extra shipping costs or taxes or what have you, the party making that promise or representation to another person will not act on those rights. And two, that the other person relies on that promise or representation, acts in a particular way, such as to buy the book. The first party, i.e. the government, is just stopped in equity from growing back on this promise and now deciding to act on those rights. They are not allowed to do so. This is so, notwithstanding that no consideration was provided by the other person in exchange for that original promise. President, the doctrine of equitable estoppel has over the years been applied by our courts in many, many cases, and I need not go into the doctrine any further. The original bill, when gazetted, is the foremost, if not the only, authority for citizens or people who have to pay and who do not have to pay BSD. They have to rely on the bill in order to make that decision before they enter into any acquisition or transaction. And the original bill has clearly and expressly excluded adults from signing sell and purchase agreements as trustees for Hong Kong permanent resident minors, excluding them from the liability of this new tax. Furthermore, after the bill has been gazetted, the Inland Revenue Department has, through a Q&A section on its website, informed the public expressly that no stamp duty will be payable on agreements signed by adults and as trustees for Hong Kong permanent resident minors. A screenshot of that relevant Q&A session, which was referred to by the Honorable James Toh, and a copy of that has been provided to the Bills Committee. So there's no doubt that the administration has made a very clear representation to the world about this exemption. Thirdly, the Inland Revenue staff, as I understand, has on numerous occasions confirmed during telephone inquiries to persons at large that no stamp duty would be payable on agreements signed by adults as trustee for Hong Kong permanent residence minor. And of course, I'm referring to the stamp duty as a result of this bill. In a letter by a member of the legal profession complaining about the sudden U-turn on the part of the administration with regards to the exemption, it is stated that if the government wants to withdraw the exemption of Hong Kong permanent resident minors, advance notice has to be given to the general public before such withdrawal should take effect. If withdrawal of exemption to Hong Kong permanent resident minors was to take effect on the gazette date, there would be no such advance notice. It would adversely affect concluded transactions with retrospective effect, and the misrepresentation is unconscionable, however innocent. Mr. President, under these circumstances, it is unfair, to say the least, for the administration to now demand retrospectively that those persons who have acquired properties in reliance of the various representations and promises made by members of the Inland Revenue Department and the administration openly to the public, to now pay this special stamp duty for the transactions, especially since many of these transactions have long been completed. The injustice and unfairness of the situation is quite clear. This is not much different from the online bookshop scenario, where retrospectively we have to ask the buyer to pay for extra costs or taxes after the book has been delivered. It is unfair, unjust, verging on unconscionable conduct to say that to leave the bill open to attack on later court challenges, whether by way of judicial review or otherwise. It is regrettable that the administration does not see this, and it is our duty as legislators to make sure that we do not allow for such a retrospective clause to go through the legislative process untouched. It's ironic that the administration has asked us to believe or to rely on oral promises, which the Secretary has uttered in the past few days, that we are to trust oral promises made by the administration. Yet, ironically, even something printed in the blue bill, even something printed in your website, or through representations made by the administration in black and white, can be withdrawn this way. How could anyone be expected, to rely or to believe the oral promises that is now made by the administration. It is absurd. After all, what is at stake we're talking about is the cardinal principles of the rule of law, the principle of legal certainty, which I have in my speech earlier touched upon, which I, if I may, Mr. President, elaborate by reference to a judgment by the former Chief Justice, Mr. Andrew Lee, in the Court of Final Appeal decision of Solicitor versus the Law Society of Hong Kong, in which the former Chief Justice said, and I quote, "Certainty in the law and predictability and consistency in its application are of great importance. They provide the foundation for the orderly conduct of commercial, business, and other activities. When disputes arise, they provide the basis for the negotiation and conclusion of compromises to settle them." So there you have it. Certainty in the law, predictability and consistency. Those are the principles that we have long thrived on, that those are the key elements of our legal system. The need for legal certainty was echoed by the Secretary for Housing and Transport himself in his speech yesterday. The importance of certainty, hence, he said, the need to pass this bill as soon as possible, leaving no room for doubts. Yet, by its very action, the administration is creating uncertainty through the retrospective effect of its U-turn on policy. The need for legal certainty is precisely why the government should not now be allowed to go back and demand special stamp duty from those who relied on the administration's own representations and promises. Retrospective legislation, Mr. President, is the very hallmark of legal uncertainty, which our tradition has always detested. Ironically, the government itself has on different occasions admitted to the undesirability of allowing adjustment to the special stamp duty regime to take retrospective effect. In the administration's most recent response to the CSA proposed by the Honorable Martin Liao, the Transport and Housing Bureau writes, and I quote, "The government is concerned that although the scrutiny period is limited to 6 months, such an adjustment mechanism would still create uncertainty for the market. Uncertainty for the market, as the new rates announced in the Gazette notice would still be subject to change. If the government's proposal adjustment is voted down by LegCo, or if LegCo's scrutiny is not completed within the six-month period, the proposed new rates would cease to have effect. The original rates would then apply, and retrospectively, thus affecting all transactions that have taken place during that interim period. The government would have to collect any stamp duty unpaid or refund excessive stamp duty collected, as the case may be. This would also cause confusion to the market and bring inconvenience to relevant sectors." Unquote. Now, there you have it. The administration itself is allegedly concerned about uncertainty to the market. The administration itself is allegedly concerned about having to go back to people and ask them to pay more taxes, or in cases where they have to refund taxes, causing uncertainty. Yet by its very own U-turn on its own policy, by adopting the Honorable Regina Yip's CSA with retrospective effect, it is causing the very uncertainty which you say you want to avoid. Mr. President, to prevent the present bill from taking retrospective effect and violating the cardinal principle of legal certainty, and to prevent the present bill from, as the Bureau describes it, causing confusion to the market and bringing inconvenience to relevant sectors, I'm moving an amendment to stipulate that the Honorable Regina Yip's CSA, now adopted by the administration, removing HKPR minus exception, would only apply in all future transactions, and it will not apply retrospectively to those acquisitions made before the gazetto of this amendment ordinance. And although I'm not permitted to move the CSA at this stage, but I will do so with the same reasons. But for now, I have put my reasons forward as to why the CSA has to be moved. Thank you, Mr. President.
In order to avoid misunderstanding, perhaps I should point out that Mr. Dennis Kwok's remarks just now about retroactivity were mainly about his amendment on Clause 17. That is the second amendment to be moved by Mr. Dennis Kwok. The second amendment of Mr. Dennis Kwok will be handled later. That amendment, in actual fact, involves the amendment now being moved by the Secretary, that is the content of the first amendment of Mr. Dennis Kwok, that's about retroactivity. Therefore, members, when considering whether or not to support this particular amendment, should make reference to Mr. Dennis Kwok's remarks just now. That's why I allowed Mr. Dennis Kwok to air his views. Mr. Abraham Sheikh.
I must pay my respect to the advocacy delivered by Kwok-hung to the extent that he actually gives us a lesson on the drafting of bill. I hope that the government could have listened to you earlier so they would not make the mistake that you have identified. Kwok-hung talked about the principles of drafting, certainty, predictability. But there is one element you forgot to speak out, is equity. Equity, by the stroke of a pen through the government, in the hands of Regina's Ip, the miners, Hong Kong permanent resident miners, were wiped out from the exemption. Those were their rights, and this is what I'll be speaking. Concerning the loopholes relating to the Hong Kong permanent residence miners, the administration again fails to convince, even as Kwok-hung used in earlier, primary school children by playing around with legal advices. Earlier, the secretary was talking about what he, in taking over Regina's amendment, he again consulted legal advice that they were right in, that they were right in adopting that particular amendment and move it forward to the electrical for passage. But he forgot about earlier, as Kwok-hung also mentioned in his speech, that he actually, the government officials actually make representation that those people, the miners, Hong Kong permanent residence miners, do have that right. If I may quote the bill, the original bill put forward to us, the bill proposes, Mr. President, that open inverted commas, quote, BSD would be levied on agreements for sale and conveyances on sale of residential properties executed by any person, including companies, who is not a Hong Kong permanent resident. For a Hong Kong permanent resident to be exempted from the BSD, the Hong Kong permanent resident must be the purchaser, transferee, acting on his or her own behalf in the acquisition of the residential property, unless the person is a HKPR minor or mentally incapacitated person who, due to the lack of capacity to enter into legally binding agreement, must in practice require another person to act on his and her behalf. To cater for their needs, the bill proposes that if a residential property is acquired on behalf of a HKPR minor or a mentally incapacitated person by his or her guardian or trustee, the minor or mentally incapacitated person will be treated as a purchaser in the place of the trustee or the guardian, so that if other conditions are met, the instruments affecting the relevant transaction would be exempted from the BSD, the beneficial interest of the residential property so acquired rests with the HKPR minor, mentally incapacitated person concerned. In brief, the administration initially held the view that all HKPRs who could satisfy the relevant requirements as set out in the bill, regardless of whether they were minors or mentally incapacitated persons, should be entitled to the same exemption from the BSD. The administration even offer a caveat, as the Honorable James Fung mentioned earlier, to this council that, quote, the suggestions to exempt HKPR parent, trustee, guardian acting on behalf of a HKPR minor from the BSD would likely to be discriminatory against certain PR minors based on the HKPR status of their parents, trustee, or guardians. Legal advice sought by the administration, initial legal advice sought by the administration indicates, he forgot the secretary forgot to mention this advice, indicated that any proposal to impose arbitrary restriction on BSD exemption for those HKPR minors whose parents, guardian, trustees are not HKPR is likely to be discriminatory and may infringe the right to equality of the relevant HKPRs, and such an approach would have human rights implications. In line with the policy intent to accord priority to Hong Kong ownership needs of HKPR under the current tight housing supply situation, or Hong Kong permanent resident minors, regardless of the HKPR status of their parents, guardians, or trustee, should be entitled to the same exemption. This was written in the bill, and this was also further represented by a government official during our bill's committee. Your memory may be short, but ours are still there. And it's shameful for a government to stand up and defend about talking about legal right when you make representation in this council. What do you treat this council as? It's a shame, really a shame. I feel ashamed to associate with people like that, who on one hand earlier asked us to trust you. Trust me. How can we trust you? When someone asks you to trust him, means that the first thing is be careful, don't trust him, because he's not to be trusted. But when deliberation reached stalemate, when the administration was stumped by the question about possible abuse of HKPR minors, in particularly the Song Fei children, by their parents, guardian, or trustee using the name of HKPR, which would counteract the policy objective of according priority to the home ownership needs of HKPR, the administration flip-flopped dramatically without shame and without ethics, saying that the Honourable Regina Ip's CSA, the proposed outright withdrawal of BSD exemption from the acquisition made on behalf of HKPR minors, was acceptable from a policy and legal perspective. It might be from a policy perspective, but definitely different from the legal interpretation earlier. Mr. Secretary, tell us, give us the fact of those two, give us the legal opinion that you have represented to this council. The administration even said the proposal would safeguard the BSD effectiveness by according priority to the home ownership needs of HKPRs, but without resulting in any difference in treatment between minors with HKPR trustee or guardians and those with non-HKPR trustee or guardians, considering that the CSA would result in tightening the BSD regime, then enhancing its effectiveness in according priority to the home ownership needs of HKPR, and bearing in mind some members' view that minors are generally expected to take care of by and stay with their parents or guardians, and accordingly, their housing needs would not be prejudiced per se by itself. Political expediency, political pressure, and fundamental rights, completely different. What is political expedience cannot overcome fundamental rights, and rights has always the priority over political expedience, Mr. Secretary. What is so bizarre about the shift of the administration's position is that the administration began warily, fearingly to discriminate against HKPR minors and infringe their rights to equality and hence their human rights. Clearly, the administration held a rights-based legal perspective and adopted a legal advice based on this perspective, they might have a different lawyer in the, during the second legal advice. Now the same administration, this same administration is adopting an entirely different legal perspective, saying that the Honourable Regina's CSA, now the government CSA, will not result in any difference in treatment between the minors with HKPR trustee or guardian and those with non-HKPR trustee or guardian, as well as safeguarding the effectiveness of the BSD above everything, even above the law, in according to the priority to the home ownership needs of the HKPRs. In truth, all the HKPR minors, people who are under 18, their rights would be forfeited if the government CSA is passed. And anybody who supports this, be accountable to those who are under 18. Come 2016, I will make sure I will advertise openly in the newspaper to remind them, those voters who deprive our 18 years old minors, that their rights have been taken away. This, I promise, I will do whether I'm a legal member or not. I will put the name of those people who deprived the people of Hong Kong, the minors, their rights. Shame on you people. Sorry, Mr. President. By the same administration adopting in truth, all the, my apologies. We have to ask ourselves first, what's wrong with the administration? Was the legal advice wrong in the first place? If it's wrong, why don't they tell us? Not a word was mentioned. Or has the administration no principle? Yes, they don't have any principles. To the point that it would create different sets of legal advice subject to its needs, as long as its primary objective is met. And in this case, getting the bill passed. That's why you make a promise using Chong Dun Check in your proposal of changing the Gala. Huh? So I really find it amazing to hear the Secretary speak without shame, without elements of principle. This is not you, Mr. Secretary. I always think that you are a person of principle. I'm not attacking you, but you're representing something which actually have been enshrined in our record. I humbly urge our honourable colleagues, particularly those in the opposition who are legal angels and who during the past been perceived as the custodians of our rights and the defender of faith in protection of our core values, please speak out. When the government said that our minors have rights, and nobody spoke against it. But when our government decided, better than Yan Dai Shang Wei, Sik Fat, then they said they don't have it. Speak out. Let Hong Kong people hear your views. I might be wrong, because I'm not a lawyer. I have strong reservations about this government flip-flop. The administration rationale for removing the BSD exemption from the minors across the board, which would have affected not only children born to mainland parents, the Song Fei, but also children born to the HKPR parents in Hong Kong, where freedom and liberty are preached and enshrined, particularly by my members on my right-hand side. The priority of the rights over good must be underlined. Article 25 of the Basic Law, which I have hammered home again and again, states that all Hong Kong citizens are equal before the law, irrespective of their age. Article 24 of the Basic Law defines residents of Hong Kong Special Administration Regions as including permanent and non-permanent residents. It would be dangerous to accept the administration rationale, which is liable to challenges by judicial review, for one thing. It would discriminate against HKPR minors who are also HKPRs. They should be entitled to protection of the Basic Law, which you have stripped them of. For another It would also impose an equal treatment in terms of BSD exemption between HKPR minors, including the Xiongfei and the mentally incapacitated persons. If the administration considers the mental ability of HKPR minors is not sufficient to guide them in making their own decisions regarding property acquisition, how could the administration justify itself and convince the public and this council that the mental ability of mentally incapacitated persons could be used to take advantage of them by their trustee or guardians when the bill does not restrict whosoever be their trustee or guardians? The administration's assertions that granting BSD exemption to HKPR minors would create loopholes. There are two bigs to pluck in an opinion. That's your problem. But you cannot take the rights out from them. Not a reason its assertion has no loopholes with the right from granting BSD exemption to mentally incapacitated persons is also an opinion, not a reason. Thank you.
Mrs. Regina Ip. Mr. Chairman, the amendments being scrutinized involve my proposal to cancel the BSD exemption for Hong Kong PR minors. That is why I'd like to speak briefly. I like to propose the amendment because during the drafting stage of the bill, when members discovered that Hong Kong PR minors will be exempted from paying BSD, we believe a big loophole will be created, because in the last 10 years, there would have been like 200,000 such children, many of them born to mainland parents. In other words, the mainland parents can come to Hong Kong to buy residential property without paying BSD. Also in the future, and it can spark more mainlanders and outsiders to come to Hong Kong to give birth so they do not have to pay BSD. The Bills Committee was very concerned. Many members spoke to point out this extraordinarily big loophole, that it is a bigger loophole than exemption for Hong Kong PR companies. That is why I'm moving or proposing the amendment. And then I have found that there may be other consequences as detailed by Mr. Abraham Shek and Mr. Dennis Kwok. In the past year or so, some people thought that Hong Kong PR minors would have exemption, so they bought in to the market, and now members are receiving complaints and they are looking into the legal issues. And some complainants have shown me the letters written by their lawyers to make inquiries with the administration. I have looked at the response of the administration. I think the administration has been very cautious with the diction. It says that this is a proposal, that the exemption for minors is just a proposal. And it also says that it's subject to the passage of this bill. In other words, if the bill is passed, there will be exemption. Now, if that is the diction used, I have also asked for other advice from lawyers. And it is said that this is just a bill and LegCo has to endorse it before it is a fact. Now, they may think that they need not pay tax, and now that they have to, they may think it's unfair. I don't know whether court case would be won. Some barristers are looking at me. Maybe you should give it a try. And I asked the administration again, and the administration said that any bills, any proposals are just proposals. You cannot assume that it will be passed, because the LegCo can amend the bill, and therefore the principle is that the administration will not refund people who have bought residential property. I think that is reasonable. That is why I'm not moving an amendment like that of Mr. Dennis Kwok. All in all, I think the loophole should be plugged, and I'm very happy that the administration has adopted my amendment, because it will have a higher chance of endorsement. I'd like also to respond briefly to the unfairness, deprivation of the right of people under 18 to buy property, as mentioned by Mr. Abraham Shek. I'd just like to make a point. Now, common sense has it that a person will never be under 18 all the time. He may just have to wait a few years before he can buy residential property. So this is not a deprivation of his right to buy property forever. He will just have to wait a few years. Why would people want to buy property for minors? Well, the possible consideration may be this tax exemption. And I think this is not that unfair. If you want to buy property for your children, then wait a few years until your children are more mature. That is why I support the administration's amendment. Ms. Starry Lee? Mr. Chairman, the DAB supports the administration's amendment. At the Bills Committee, DAB members expressed that we would be very concerned about the original exemption in the bill. That is, Hong Kong PR minors would not have to pay BSD. We thought that it could be abused. Minors cannot protect themselves, and the relevant exemption can easily be abused. I remember that was also the time for kindergarten parents to be lining up, and a lot of agencies were lining up for mainland parents whose children were born in Hong Kong. I remember that was the clause-by-clause examination period, and members of different political affiliations have said that they are worried the relevant exemption could be abused, more so because of the presence of agencies. And the loophole is actually a bigger one than that for Hong Kong PR companies. Some members of the Bills Committee felt very strongly about this. As Mr. Andrew Leung said, members from the business community made the same point, and that is Hong Kong PR companies will not be exempted because of the loophole, but if exemption is afforded to minors, the loophole may even be bigger. Mrs. Regina Ip then put forward an amendment, as she said, and we agree with this arrangement in order to plug the relevant loophole. We understand the points made by Mr. Abraham Shack that we may be depriving the right of minors to buy property, but we said many times that these are extraordinary measures for exceptional times. Some people will, of course, be affected. According to information from the administration, in the past, there have been just very few cases of minors buying through trustees. And it is just common sense that usually minors will probably be living with their families, and then when they are financially independent, they will have more need for buying property. So if this is just an extraordinary measure for exceptional times, we believe this broad brush approach would be comparatively simple and direct in tackling the loophole. So the DAB supports it. The DAB does not support the proposal by Mr. James Toh. He tightens up exemption for the mentally incapacitated. But as some members pointed out, it is somehow controversial because it goes further to deprive the right of certain people to be exempted from paying BSD. After balancing the situation, we think the present approach is appropriate. That's all for me. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Kenneth Leung?
I would like to briefly recall the history of this lifting of the exemption for minors under the age of 18. In fact, I'm much disappointed that the administration, when they originally drafted this bill, has not taken into account of this loophole. If I remember it correctly, I think I was one of the members who has raised this concern that the loophole may be used by minors or the guardians or the parents of minors who are entitled to a Hong Kong permanent ID card who were born in Hong Kong but in fact are not residing in Hong Kong and have no other connection with Hong Kong to exploit this loophole in order to get exemption from buyer's stamp duty. Now, in fact, if the administration has the vision and technical ability to get the whole picture, now they should have come up with some provision to avoid the exploitation of the use of trust in order to benefit the parent or the guardian or the trustee. The reason why I have come up with my committee stage amendment on domicile is trying to stop the loophole without putting through some amendment which are arbitrary, discriminatory, and I think also inequitable. Now, in the government's response to the issues raised at meetings of the Bills Committee dated 20th December 2013, it said, now this response was only given to the Bills Committee on 20th December, which is about 12 months after the Bills Committee came into operation. And I'm so surprised that this big loophole has not even thought about by any of the law drafting, by any of the staff of the administration. Now, it said, having regard to the fact that minors lack the capacity to enter into legally binding agreements and, in practice, require another person to act on his or her behalf in acquiring a residential property, the bill has included, this is the original bill, of course, before Regina Ip's amendment, has included a provision that if a trustee or a guardian acquires a residential property, the minor will be treated as a purchaser under the agreement for sale in place of the trustee or guardian. Mr. President, of course, the issue in particular of Song Fei did exist for a long time before the drafting of the bill. Now, the government further explained it in this response that the government, in response to the Honourable Regina Ip's Committee State Amendment, which seeks to remove such exemption, which is the BSD exemption, and having considered the Honourable Regina Ip's CSA, would result in tightening up of the BSD regime and enhancing its effectiveness in achieving the policy objectives. Now, of course, it does achieve the policy objective. But however, is this amendment legal? Is this amendment equitable? Now, the Honourable Abraham Shack has repeatedly stated that under Article 25 of the Basic Law, it said all Hong Kong residents shall be equal before the law. And, of course, Article 24 of the Basic Law provides that residents of the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region shall include permanent residents and non-permanent residents. As such, I also heard that the administration has already sought legal advice to the legality of such provision, namely removing the exemption from BSD for minors. However, I'm still not convinced. If you are open government, please show us this legal advice. Apart from the basic law, I'm also aware that there may be some infringement on other international conventions which may contain age discrimination provisions, our bills of rights, and other considerations. My question to the administration is, have you also considered these issues, and have you also got any legal opinion from any council regarding these issues? If you have done so, could you show the council, you haven't done so, to the Bills Committee, these legal opinions? Now, these are my concerns. Now, these are real concerns because if ever this bill was passed and enacted, and if the whole thing becomes law, the administration will be inevitably subject to judicial review, because if I were a minor and my parents are Hong Kong permanent residents, and I'm also a permanent resident of Hong Kong, why should I be denied of the rights to this exemption because of this arbitrary 18 line drawn above my head? My honourable colleague Regina has also mentioned that things will change because, you know, people grow older and you will be entitled to the exemption after you attain the age of 18. But as you all know, as we all know, the property market fluctuates so much. The parents, the Hong Kong parents especially, would like to cater for the miners. They would like to buy properties for the miners when they're young so that when they grow up, these properties can be transferred back to the miners. Now, how can you deny the Hong Kong parents from doing so? Why should you be denying Hong Kong miners with Hong Kong permanent resident parents from doing the necessary planning for these miners? Now, of course, I'm convinced that your solution to the issue of this loophole is a quick fix. But, Mr. President, a quick fix is often a bad fix as well. So, please, I would like the administration to give us all the explanation necessary in order for me to consider supporting this amendment. Thank you, Mr. President.
梁家琪議員，主席。
Mr. Alan Leong.
Mr. Chairman, I would just like to say this. The Secretary said that he could not support Mr. James Toh's amendment. And let's take a look at the wording in the blue bill and the CSA moved by Mr. James Toh. And let's look at the difference between the two. Now, Mr. James Toh says very clearly that the guardian or the trustee have to comply with Cap 136, the Mental Health Ordinance. In other words, the guardian or the trustee has to be appointed under Cap 136. But then the blue bill simply says, let me give you this example. (29CB)(8)(B), Hong Kong permanent resident and is mentally incapacitated. And then C1386, page C1386, there is a definition for mentally incapacitated person. And it says, this means a person who is mentally disordered or mentally handicapped within the meaning of the Mental Health Ordinance, Cap 136. So I want to ask the Secretary this question, and I hope that he can give me a reply later. And that is it that the administration foresees the following scenario, and that is a person has been satisfy the definition in the Mental Health Ordinance concerning mental disorder and mental handicapped, and then there is a trustee or a guardian who hasn't been duly appointed. So this trustee or guardian acquires property on behalf of this mentally incapacitated person. I find it hard to imagine such things happening. So a person who is mentally disordered or mentally handicapped within the meaning of the Mental Health Ordinance, he is not in a position to manage his own assets or his own life. How come all of a sudden there is someone coming out claiming that he is acquiring property on behalf of this mentally incapacitated person? I find it difficult to imagine that such things will happen. The Secretary urged members not to support Mr. James Toh's amendment. He is of the view that Mr. James Toh's amendment will unnecessarily restrict or hinder the acquisition of property on the part of mentally incapacitated persons. So can I ask the Secretary to share with us the legal advice that he has obtained. Now, there are people who are mentally disordered or mentally handicapped. They are mentally incapacitated. And yet, suddenly, someone comes out and claims that I am acquiring property on behalf of this mentally incapacitated person. And how does the administration judge whether this person is mentally incapacitated or not? Now, the secretary seems to suggest that Mr. James Toh's amendment is unnecessary. So please explain why it is unnecessary. And what's more, you are saying that the amendment will restrict the rights of these persons. So in what way will the rights of these mentally incapacitated persons be restricted? So I hope that the secretary can elaborate in his reply. Chairman, Mr. Abraham Shek, and I want to say that the Civic Party supports the proposed amendment by Mrs. Regina Ip, and I understand that this has become the administration's CSA. So these HKPRs, and we do understand that their rights to acquire property before or under the age of 18 will be affected. But then we know that these are extraordinary measures needed for extraordinary times. And so the Civic Party is of the view that the amendment can be supported. But it doesn't mean that the Civic Party is unaware of the rights of those under 18 being affected by the amendment. It doesn't mean that we are not aware of the implications. And then Mr. Dennis Kwok will move an amendment to Section 70. So I think the administration is not groundless in what it is proposing. But then I think Mr. Kwok has told you the difficulties faced by the legal sector, especially solicitors involved in the conveyancing business. Now, say if I'm a Hong Kong permanent resident, I want to acquire property, and the blue bill says that the measures, the demand management measures are not targeted at Hong Kong permanent residents, but buyers from outside. And if a Hong Kong permanent resident goes to acquire property, the lawyer has to ask him to pay the BSD under the present form of the blue bill. And of course, the buyer will resent this idea. And I think we can understand his feelings. It is said that the bill targets outside buyers. And so for Hong Kong permanent residents who are adults who wish to acquire property, and if they are asked by their lawyers to pay the BSD, of course they will feel offended. But if this Hong Kong permanent resident wishes to sell property, then that's a different story. You know, the longer the holding period, the lower the SSD rate. And so if this person is selling the flat with a holding period of less than 3 years, then of course the lawyer will have to get the SSD from this person. But secretary, you can see that the situation is very different from the buyer's perspective and from the seller's perspective. Now, for the seller, so the lawyer can get the SSD first, and then if the bill is not passed, and then the amount can be reimbursed. But then if a Hong Kong permanent resident wants to buy property and he is not buying by way of a company, then if the duty is not to be paid, and I don't think that will really create a very serious problem.
So is the secretary totally unreasonable? No, he's not totally unreasonable, but he is not compassionate enough. Concerning Clause 17 of the Blue Bill, which is to amend section, that is to add Section 70, I hope that the secretary will take into account that regard. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Leung Kwok-hung, Mr. Chairman, I participated in the campaign against tobacco duties, so yesterday I did not participate in this debate. I'll support Mr. James Toh's amendment. Well, of course, I won't support the administration's amendment. Something is very strange. Well, the government said that Mrs. Regina Ip's amendment is reasonable, so the administration is to support her. And then the administration also said Mr. James Toh's amendment is reasonable, but then the government will reject Mr. James Toh's amendment. Why is it so? Well, Mr. Alan Leung just told me that there's a difference between a friend and a foe. Well, you cannot act casually and randomly. You cannot be selective in this regard. This attitude of the administration is not one of a consultative one. Well, there is this political slogan that there can be discussions between the government and the public, blah, blah, blah. Well, all these problems arise out of your negative vetting proposal, and now you're adopting a friend and foe approach. Why should we support Mrs. Regina Ip's amendment? Well, the government is playing politics. CY Leung would like to use the dual harsh measures to handle the property market, and he acted hastily. What's happening now? He conducted a political act. He said that when he assumed office, he would resolve problems that emerged before he came to office. But then the HOS market has been chaotic. 5,000 HOS flats were promised, and the property prices rose. Well, they casually and randomly prescribed cures to the problem, and just one stone can spark huge waves. And you see, the government is saying all these kind words for the sake of land developers. Now let's look at this negative vetting approach. Colleagues cited a lot of examples where we had negative vetting. In Hong Kong, we have this very speculative market for a long, long time, which led to some people becoming rich. Well, this speculation phenomenon has been in existence for a long time. Well, in fact, they also suffer from risks, even with this negative vetting approach. The government is saying that we may offer such exemptions if the LegCo supports the administration. These are risks as well. Are you certain that the LegCo will obey you? You cannot cite this reason. The government has already said something. If some people, after listening to the government, treat that as a message, and then they act in the market, they may suffer. The government is to look at this situation where the government has made a number of mistakes and is now trying to rectify the situation. That's why it is proposing this negative vetting approach. But those parties who are to benefit may not actually benefit in the end. Well, I can imagine what COI Leung would be saying. Anthony Cheung and his team may be saying this. In future, the LegCo led by Mr. Jasper Zhang is a rubber stamp. You don't need to worry. If this gets enacted, well, it will be enacted. I'll stamp it. Don't oppose me. There's no reason for this council to obey the government just because they're saying that. Why do I agree to Mrs. Regina Ip's opinion? Frankly speaking, we're now talking about the minor HKPRs, those under the age of 18. Well, you are saying that the parents will buy properties on their behalf. I think you are joking. In my estate, I can't even buy a toy. In my estate, a new toy shop was opened. Many poor children very much want to have toys from that shop. I can recall that in one incident, a child stole a Disneyland-related toy. I told the story before in this chamber. The child's mother was convened to the shop. Her daughter was crying, and that toy only costed $20. You see, our poor people can't even afford a toy of $20. So why should we prohibit these people from buying properties? This is a piece of legislation. We always say, the pandemocrats always say that we should have the rule of law. We should abide by our laws. Well, I hate CY Leung most. I really want to attack him, but in vain. He is incompetent. He speaks without acting, but eventually, due to certain pressures, he had resorted to the due harsh measures, although he knew that the due harsh measures would not be effective. So why should we leave an obvious loophole here? And the loophole is to cater to the needs of the rich people on the mainland. Chairman, every day I'm handling cases with children with one non-local parent or two non-local parents. Now, these people don't have the capacity to buy properties for their children. When the government first acted, why, in principle, I very much oppose the negative vetting approach. If you want to have negative vetting, tell us the limitation. Well, when there is to be military rule or whatnot. Well, this government does not follow rules and regulations, right? A lot of tax items are like that, like smoking. I asked the administration, Chairman, I recall you're also there. They wanted negative vetting for the tobacco tax. Well, if there's not to be any increase, where will the money go? They say the rich people. Oh, yes, you think for the rich people. The money will be deposited with the lawyers and then be distributed. I asked, what about the smokers then? They said if you could keep the cigarette packet, you'll try and see whether you could get a refund. Well, there's a reason for me to say that, because very soon we'll have an increase in tobacco tax. To an extent that will be scared. The administration does not consider the poor people at all. It only considers the rich people. Same for our councillors. So who speculate on properties should die first. Well, these people told us something about economy. Chairman, they said Hong Kong's economy is very special. They use their property as a pledge, a mortgage, to get out a loan from the bank. Well, I'm not familiar with Mrs. Regina Ip. I don't like her person. But then she's really too unreasonable. She is actually trying to evade tax by moving this amendment. Do you have any friend who can think of this? Well, son, when you're below 16 years old, when you're 16, I'll buy your property. Well, these children depend on their parents. So this proposal would not be effective. In this council, whose interest should we protect? So there's no way out for me. I support her in tears. Dennis Kwok, you see, they're saying that the harsh measures are so harsh that people won't be able to tolerate. Well, it doesn't matter. With these harsh measures, people will be driven to other speculative activities. They speculate on car parking spaces, etc., etc. Oh, you haven't been speculating on car parking spaces? Really? I respect you. It's just like Kwok-hung. He severely scolded the speculators on properties, but he himself also changed his property. He upgraded his Southern Horizons flat. I mentioned a lot of things. These people complain about the odor in the toilet while they're eating the feces there. That's what Kwok-hung is doing. Chairman, you cannot stop me from saying that. Chairman, there's no alternative for me. CY Leung, you're really able. The due harsh measures are neither here nor there. We say we're hungry, then you mix feces with beef for me. The poor people don't have beef to eat, so I've no way out. I have to support you. I fully oppose CY Leung's move in treating us as rubber stamps by putting forth this negative vetting approach. And now we're here without knowing what to do. I support him, but I have to scold him. Chairman, you need not worry. I'm not digressing. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. James Toh? Mr. Chairman, I discovered that some colleagues might not understand my amendment. Perhaps previously I was too modest in my remarks. Well, let me explain the possible abuse. For a mentally incapacitated person, why are we saying that only a person appointed by a legal or statutory proceedings should serve as the guardian? It's like this. Say if I buy a property, whether or not for speculation, well, originally I have to pay 15% of buyer stamp duty. It's quite a lot. And then I try to think of a trick to bypass that. Then I say that I'm helping a mentally incapacitated person in buying a flat. But of course, the money does not come from the mentally incapacitated person because he does not have money and he cannot get my money. So I pay. It's my money. I may be a mainlander. So the deed will say that I'm a trustee. So it's tantamount to I giving the money to the mentally incapacitated person who is the beneficiary of the flat.
By definition, the mentally incapacitated person does not have the capacity mentally to chase me up for the money. And I don't even have to tell the mentally incapacitated person that I have this trust on behalf of him. Why do I have to tell him? I'll just write it in the deed. In other words, the deed, the purchase agreement, whatever, everything would be in my safe deposit box. I, as the trustee, would represent this person and sell the property, and then the money will be with me. From the point of trust, since the money comes from the property sold under trust, I will be holding the money in trust. But that person has never known that he has got property in the first place. In other words, the self-claim of a trustee is something very dangerous. I therefore say that if the administration itself is saying that it would ask for some documents administratively, whether he has an order appointing him, he says no, I don't have the order, so what? But I can give you the entrustment. You talk about a trust in the law. You don't say I should be related to him, whether I am his parent or guardian or daughter. So I already have given you the evidence because I have got the order. However, if I in the law I state that the guardian and trustee must be appointed according to legal procedures, then in other words, from the court's perspective, the court would know that you are related to him somehow, that you would protect his interests, so it's appropriate for you to be the trustee. And there would be good reason for you to buy property on his behalf. So at least there is a procedure which is proper to tell the court and convince the court that you need to set up that relationship with him. Then that would be the way to prevent abuse. That's what I mean. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Dennis Kwok, would you like to speak? I don't need to speak again at this stage. The secretary, would you like to speak again? Chairman, I'd like to briefly respond to the views of members and also their questions. First, let me reiterate, as I pointed out about Mr. James Toh's amendment, and that is dealing with Hong Kong PR who are mentally incapacitated. The administration is not different from Mr. James Toh in terms of direction and principle. Both feel that if mentally incapacitated Hong Kong PR have the need to buy property, then they can do so through their trustee or guardian. That is something necessary. So the question is about the extent. Let me talk about the background and why we have this issue. I totally agree with members in saying that when we drafted the bill, we need to be lawful, reasonable, and sympathetic. So we make the best arrangement. This is about mentally incapacitated persons. In the bill, they are put together with Hong Kong PR minors, and they were given the same treatment. In other words, both would not be able to sign legally binding agreements, so trustees or guardians would have to do it on their behalf. The original arrangement for both groups, say who are the trustees, who are the guardians, all that is already defined in the bill. Then at the Bills Committee, we thank members for reminding us and pointing out to us that with regard to Hong Kong PR minors, if their parents are non-Hong Kong PR persons, and yet they purchase property on behalf of these minors in the name of a trustee or guardian, then a loophole will appear. There were strong views about this at the Bills Committee. In the end, the administration thinks we should face squarely up to this issue, and Mrs. Regina Ip proposed an amendment so that originally the exemption given to Hong Kong PR minors who purchase residential property through a trustee or guardian, in other words, these people sign legally binding documents on their behalf, they would not be exempted from paying BSD. That's the background. So originally, Hong Kong PR minors were put into the same category as mentally incapacitated persons, but now they are taken out. And from our angle, there is no need to further tighten the exemption given to MIs in the original provision. In other words, if their trustees or guardians tackle transactions on their behalf, the exemption will remain. We say there is no need to further tighten the provisions because originally the exemption applied to both groups of Hong Kong PRs. Mr. James Toh says that he would like to tighten the exemption so that the trustees or guardians should be appointed according to the MHO or a court order before they can enjoy BSD exemption. The biggest difference between ourselves and Mr. Toh is that in the original bill, there was also a limit. And at present, when the IRD processes the buyer's statutory declaration, if they say they act on behalf of Hong Kong PR MIs, they must produce documentary evidence and also a valid and legally binding entrustment. If the IRD would think it necessary, they have to provide more evidence. As for guardians, they have to provide documentary evidence to prove that they are the legal guardian of the MI, now including a guardianship order issued by the court. But if they are not in this category, they will not be exempted. So in spirit, in terms of direction, we are not different from Mr. James Toh. That is why we say we do not have to further tighten the arrangement, because when the IRD vets and approves documentary evidence, the existing mechanism is already on a very firm foundation. Mr. Abraham Shek also spoke I think Mr. Ibrahim Shek has not been fair in his remarks. He asked whether the DOJ gave very different legal advice. In other words, that it was against the principle of estoppel, and then there was not the contravention of the principle. I think he has mixed up two matters. Let me now revisit the process at the Bills Committee. At the beginning, as I said, the bill provides exemption to Hong Kong PR minors who sign legal documents on their behalf or who have trustees, guardians signing on their behalf. They enjoy BSD exemption. But at the Bills Committee, many members pointed out there could be a loophole. If their parents are non-Hong Kong PRs, meaning that these children are born to mainland parents, there were strong concerns expressed about this loophole, and the administration was told to give serious consideration to plugging of that loophole. The view was whether something could be done to target mainland parents whose children are born in Hong Kong and who may exploit their children who are Hong Kong PR minors in order to circumvent the BSD. I think Mr. Ibrahim Shek read a paper from the THB carrying the legal advice, and this paper was in October last year. In English, it reads,
examining these suggestions in detail. However, we must caution that any proposal to impose arbitrary restriction on the BSD exemption for those HKPR minors whose parents are not HKPRs is likely to be discriminatory and may infringe the right to equality of the relevant HKPRs. 中文的文本的寫法就說,
in Chinese, it says we have to point out that if we arbitrarily impose limitation on parents who are both non-Hong Kong PRs, and if such Hong Kong PR minors are limited in those kinds of purchase, then such proposals may be discriminatory and it may infringe upon equal treatment for Hong Kong PRs. So what we are targeting here is that if both are Hong Kong PR minors, you are only saying that if for one group the parents are mainland parents, then the treatment would be different from other PR minors. We felt that that could be challenged. In other words, there was unequal treatment. Later on, we studied the legal point together with the DOJ again. And what we have today in front of you is an amendment which governs all Hong Kong PR minors. All of them would not enjoy BSD exemption. In other words, there is no differential treatment for Hong Kong PR minors. I'd like to clarify that point. Now, of course, this brings us to another fundamental issue mentioned by Mr. Ibrahim Shek and other members, and that is, why among Hong Kong PRs do we want to differentiate between adults and minors? Mr. James Toh was correct. That was a struggle for ourselves as well. On the one hand, we'd like to manage demand. We don't want to stimulate demand. On the other hand, members mentioned that if the parents are non-Hong Kong PRs, then could there be a loophole for abuse? After weighing the two issues, and we have also consulted the DOJ, and we say if we target all Hong Kong PR minors, the legal advice is such that because of the policy intent, this is legally sound. Therefore, we indeed consulted the DOJ. Therefore, the legal advice this time around is different from the legal advice we had in October, which only targeted Hong Kong PR minors whose parents are mainlanders. As for Hong Kong PR minors who purchase property through a trustee or guardian, and if they cannot enjoy BSD exemption, whether that is appropriate, I think members commented on this. Some members said the differentiation is okay, some say no. I respect your view, but I'd just like to lay in front of you the background to the issue. Mr. Dennis Kwok mentioned his amendment, and I also like to respond to that. Of course, I totally understand the starting point for Mr. Dennis Kwok's amendment. He was targeting some people who thought that according to the bill, they could be exempted from paying BSD, but in the end, after the passing of the bill, the exemption is withdrawn. And Mr. Kwok is saying whether these people's interests would be prejudiced. I totally understand the consideration and the justification, and I also totally agree with Mr. Kwok that we should have certainty in lawmaking. Indeed, we also hope that we send out clear messages in making policies and legislation. However, if we look at it from the angle of principle, all legislative processes would involve the proposal of a bill from the administration.
So the bill reflects the policy objectives of the administration. And then the bill is tabled in LegCo, and then a bills committee is set up. The bills committee may want to move some CSAs, and the bills committee may be able to detect certain problems with the bill, and sometimes the administration may decide to move CSAs. So the bill, which is passed ultimately, may be different from the originally gazetted bill. If people think that they've suffered losses because the bill has been amended, then is it that they have this legitimate expectation, and so they have this this right? Now I thank members for supporting the directions outlined in this bill. What if this bill is negatived by this council upon third reading? And what if some people come out and say, oh, if I had known that the bill would not be passed, I would have bought property, but now because of the demand management measures stated in the gazetted bill, I have not acquired a property, and now I'm suffering losses. So how are we going to address deal with these cases? So as to how many HKPR minors have acquired property since the gazetto of the bill, I don't think that's really the crux of the matter. Now, if today, if Mr. Dennis Kwok's amendment is passed, but then this bill, the passed bill, has to be gazetted before it comes to into effect. And will some people make use of the window, the period in the interim, to do certain things in the market? And so that's the background that I would like to give members with regard to Mr. Dennis Kwok's amendment. So I want to say that the administration does not support Mr. Kwok's amendment. Mr. James Toh? Chairman, the secretary keeps saying that there is no basic difference between his version and my version. But I think there is a basic difference. The secretary is of the view that administrative measures would suffice to resolve on the problem. But then in my view, the problem should be resolved by legislation. So does it mean that the the secretary doesn't think legislation is necessary, and if the person can produce the sale and purchase agreement showing the name of a trustee, and then there is someone who is mentally incapacitated, and then there is document to prove that this mentally incapacitated person is a HKPR and is also a mentally incapacitated person. Then what if a guardianship order cannot be produced? So will you charge BSD? And if he doesn't pay, then you'll go to court with him. What is the legal basis then? According to my view, there is no legal basis, and so you can't really give a refusal. So yes, I understand that administratively you are going to make this requirement. But what if they say, no, I haven't got it? So in my view, you do not have enough ammunition, legally speaking. Secretary. Now, because I'm not the Commissioner of Internal Revenue, and so I can only give a very brief reply. I understand that the Commissioner, in dealing with claims of being guardians and trustees, require those concerned to provide relevant legal documents, including guardianship orders. And Mr. James Toh is asking what will happen if people can produce some documents, but those documents are not enough in the eyes of the RRD. Does it mean that we'll have to go to court? Now, in fact, the documents are required by the RRD concerning whether we have had previous cases of the administration having to go to court. I don't have the figures here. So I'll give Mr. James Toh a chance to give a brief response, and then we'll close the debate. So, Chairman, the Secretary is of the view that my amendment is unnecessary, but then he is not saying that with my amendment there will be more loopholes, the Commissioner of Internal Revenue will have a more difficult job. So he thinks the amendment is not necessary, but I do not agree with him. I think the amendment is necessary. So I hope that members will cast their vote based on this understanding. Now, you may think this amendment is not essential, but then it would be safer, more secure to include this amendment. So please support this amendment. Mr. Leung, I think this debate has to come to an end. Mr. Leung Kwok-hung, please do not violate the rules of procedure. And I'll put the question to you, and that is that the amendment moved by Mr. James Toh, that is the first amendment in Appendix 1, be passed. And I'll put a question to you as stated. Those in favor, please raise their hands. Those against Mr. James Toh claims a division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes.
開始表決。
Voting begins. Members, please check your votes. If there are no queries, voting is closed. The results are displayed. Members returned from FCs, 26 present, 10 yes, 16 no's, no abstentions. Members from GCs, 23 present, 12 yes, 10 no's, no abstentions. The question is not agreed by a majority of each of the two groups of members present. I declare the amendment negatived. Mr. Dennis Kwok's first amendment and the secretary's second amendment are the same, and so I will only invite the secretary to move his second amendment, and I will not be inviting Mr. Dennis Kwok to move his first amendment. Secretary, please move your second amendment contained in Appendix 1. Chairman, I move the second amendment to further amend clauses 9 and 12. I now put a question to you, and that is that the secretary's second amendment be passed. And I put a question to you as stated. Will those in favor please raise their hands? Those against. Mr. Abraham Shad would like to claim a division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes.
開始表決。
Voting begins. Members, please check your votes. If there's no question, voting is now closed. Display results. Voting results, 51 present, 42 for, 8 against, no abstention. The question is agreed by a majority of the members present. I declare the amendment passed. Clause 9 as amended. I now put the question to you as stated, that is, Clause 9 as amended stands part of the bill. Will those in favor please raise their hands? Those against, please raise their hands. I think the question is agreed by a majority of members present. I declare the motion passed. We're now on page 19 of the script to handle the second amendment by Mr. James.